Good afternoon, and thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Laura Ullrich, and I'm a senior regional economist at the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond. We're really excited to have the opportunity to share with you the survey we've been working on for about a year, a little over a year. The group of attendees here is really diverse, which we're very excited about. So we have people from community colleges, administrators, faculty members, system employees. We also have nonprofit leaders and some Federal Reserve staff as well. Our hope today is that each of you will learn a little bit more about the community colleges in the 5th District. We also want you to learn about the ways they're serving 5th District communities. In addition, we hope that you also learn a bit about the data challenges that exist in the space and ways in which we believe they can be improved. To get started today, I want to go ahead and turn it over to our COO and First Vice President, Becky Bearford. Becky?
Great. Thank you, Laura. Welcome, everyone. I am glad to be able to join you today to hear the outcomes of some of the survey work that's been underway. As Laura mentioned, I'm Becky Bearford. I lead the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond as First Vice President and Chief Operating Officer. I'm also a first-generation college student from a small town in Warsaw, Virginia. So this topic hits home with me. I've seen firsthand the important role that community colleges play in small towns like mine and several of yours. In fact, my husband received his associate's degree from Rappahannock Community College in my hometown. So that's why I'm really energized by the work the Richmond Fed is now doing in this space. For many of you, this likely is the first time you've interacted with the Fed or attended one of our events, but I hope it won't be your last time and you walk away knowing the Richmond Fed cares about 5th District communities and the people in them. We care about community colleges and we care about workforce development. In fact, it's part of our public service mission and more specifically, the Federal Reserve's dual mandate. Since 1977, the Federal Reserve has operated under a mandate from Congress. The side of the mandate that often gets the most attention, especially in times like right now, is that of stable prices, which really has to do with inflation and interest rates. But the Federal Reserve also has a mandate towards maximum employment. And it's clear from prior research that education is strongly tied to employment outcomes. So we're interested in the role that higher education, and more specifically in this case, community colleges play in creating the workforce to fill the jobs of today and the jobs of tomorrow. That's why we've gathered here today. Our team saw a need, Laura's been at the helm for this, in developing and piloting a new and better way to capture data from community colleges. So that when we get asked the question, are community colleges doing a good job? We can answer it more confidently. We've been on this journey for about a year, as Laura indicated, and we think we've learned a lot already with more to go. And rest assured, we're committed to this work going forward and broadening our expansion of data gathering and intel in this space. I'm excited for you to hear from Laura and Jason about the Community College Outcome Survey and its goals, and to hear about the results from the pilot version of this project. Thank you again for joining us today, and I encourage you to go to our website, richmondfed.org, to learn more about us and the research that we are doing around workforce and community development. So with that, I'm excited to hear about the results and hand back things to Laura, and hopefully you will stay engaged and touched and giving us more data in the future. Laura?
Thanks so much, Becky. We really appreciate you being here today and supporting us on this project, for sure. A few housekeeping things before we really get started with our presentation. First of all, we will have a Q&A portion of this event at the end today. We'll be glad to answer questions and hope to get some engagement from you because we really are actively seeking feedback on this project. We still are in the pilot phase, as Becky mentioned. So there's a Q&A button at the bottom of your screen and feel free to submit questions throughout and we'll make sure to answer those at the end. In addition, I do want to point out from the beginning that We are just going to give you an insight into just a portion of what we've been doing so far in terms of this survey and the pilot. We collected a lot of data and we had to decide kind of what to show you today. But we hope we intend for this to be an ongoing project and an ongoing conversation. More to come on that as we go through today. So I'm going to go ahead and begin sharing my slides and we will jump right in. So before I get started, as Federal Reserve employees, we always get to remind people that the views that we're going to express in the presentation are those of the authors, and they don't represent an official position of the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond or the Federal Reserve System. So just an agenda of how we're going to go through this today. I'm going to start off talking about what we know about current data on community colleges in the 5th District. Jason is then going to talk to us about why we decided to do a survey and what we did in terms of the pilot survey itself. I'm going to then show you some of the results from the pilot survey, and then we'll get into kind of our future plans with the survey and ongoing research with community colleges. And like I mentioned, we'll have Q&A at the end, so please make sure to put your questions in the Q&A part of the Zoom at the bottom. So let's go into what we know about 5th District community colleges from existing data. And before I even start talking about data on community colleges, I want to make sure to talk a little bit about the 5th District, because at the Federal Reserve, we throw around terms like 5th District all the time, or Richmond Fed versus Atlanta Fed versus Philly Fed, but sometimes people don't know what that means. So let me give you a little bit of information on the 5th District. So the 5th District of the Federal Reserve, there's 12 banks across the country, and the 5th District is what we call the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond's district. And that includes the Carolinas, Virginia, West Virginia, Maryland, and DC. And you'll see that actually it only includes most of West Virginia. The very top portion of West Virginia is actually a part of the Cleveland Fed. However, for the purposes of everything we're going to talk about today, we claim West Virginia, the whole state. So we included all of West Virginia in our work. Also, you'll notice on that graph, little red dots, those represent our offices. So our main office is in Richmond, but we also have branches in Charlotte. That's actually where I work, and also in Baltimore. And so at those branches, we have everything from bank supervision to cash operations to researchers like myself. So this is our region for this survey that we're talking about today. And we had to choose a definition of community colleges, which, you know, some people might not understand, but there are some two-year schools that directly feed into four-year schools that are not part of the community college system within each state. So we excluded those schools from our survey, and we defined the community colleges basically as the technical and community colleges that participate in the state system. Based on that definition, there's 122 community colleges across our 5 states. I will note from the beginning that we will use the term community college. I know that the state of South Carolina uses the term technical college, and there are a couple of other technical colleges within our district, but since community college is the most often used term, that's what we'll use throughout. So let's start with what the data show. And I'll reiterate again what I said in the beginning. We have a really diverse group of people here. So people that are listening in that work at community colleges are going to look at this data that I'm showing right here and immediately say, that's not good data to look at to explain that from what we do. But not everybody realizes that. Not everybody realizes the limitations. So I want to make sure to talk about it. Community college outcomes don't look great on the surface. If you were to dig in and look at community college graduation rates, they are far below the outcomes of four-year colleges. And so these data here that I'm showing are from IPEDS. IPEDS is the source that many people use to pull higher education data. So this is the higher education data that are collected by the federal government. And if you look at it by sector, so here I have private four-year institutions, public four-year institutions, and then public two-year institutions. And you'll see this is in the 5th district only. And this is a weighted average. So the bigger the school, the bigger the weighting in this. This looks at graduation rates within 150% of time to expected graduation. So at a four-year school, this would measure a 6-year graduation rate. At a 2-year school, this would measure a 3-year graduation rate. And what you can see is if you pull the data from IPEDS, you'll see that the result for that 150% of time to completion, those graduation rates is less than half at community colleges, is less than half of what it is at 4-year schools. So if you look at the data on the surface, they don't, the outcomes don't look great for community colleges. And in fact, they can really look pretty especially bad. However, when I first came to the Fed, and I'll give you a little bit of background to let you know why this is kind of important to this project. I came to the Fed 3.5 years ago from higher education. I was at a public four-year institution for 13 years in South Carolina and was there as a professor and then as an administrator. And I knew we reported data to IPEDS. I used data from IPEDS, some in my own personal research on higher ed, but I didn't have a lot of experience with community colleges. So when I came to work for the Fed and we were pulling some of these data and seeing the results and then talking to community colleges, we got comments like the following: don't use that data, or the cohort that IPEDS uses really doesn't explain what we do. It doesn't accurately reflect what's going on. Or IPEDS doesn't really work for community colleges, or that's not our real graduation rate. But as an economist, right, economists, we think about how people, how institutions, how governments make decisions, right, in the decision-making process. And so it still hit me that, okay, even if this isn't the best data source, if I Google X community college, so fill in the blank, whatever community college in the fifth district, if I Google X community college graduation rate, what pops up on my screen is that IPEDS 150% of time to completion graduation rate. That is kind of thought of as the standard higher education graduation rate as reported by the government. And so people are using these rates to make decisions, right? Students are using it to make decisions on where they might want to attend college. Parents are making decisions. High school counselors are making decisions. But also employers are making decisions, right? And we hear about this, especially in terms of economic development. When companies are deciding where to locate their companies, one of the things they ask about is what are the outcomes of the community colleges in the area? Also, researchers are using these data. And if you look at the education research and economics, there's not as much data on community colleges as you might expect. And part of it, I do believe, is because of the data quality. And legislators are also making decisions based on this. And you can imagine how if they pull graduation rates in the state, and they look at it and say, why are our four-year schools doing twice as well as our two-year schools? It might be hard to explain to them, or you may not even get the chance to explain to them that it really is a data quality issue. So why doesn't this work? Why doesn't IPEDS work as well for community colleges? So the story really rolls up into how the cohort is calculated. So IPEDS uses a cohort model and then calculates graduation rates and transfer rates based on that cohort. The traditional IPEDS cohort uses first-time, full-time degree-seeking students as the group that's in the cohort. And then they, but at that point, can calculate all sorts of different, you know, graduation rates by gender, graduation rates by race, and all by Pell Grant status, and all sorts of other ways. And so they're looking at that based on this 150% of time to completion. This works relatively well for most four-year institutions. It works really well for a lot of high-performing private four-year institutions, let's say, where almost every student that enrolls is there full-time. There are very few part-time students. And they're also most likely first-time college students. So first-time college students means it's the first time they've enrolled outside of just taking some classes here or there in high school. It's the first time they've really enrolled in higher education. So that works really well for a lot of private four-year institutions. It also works well for most public four-year institutions where still most of their students or many of their students are enrolled full-time and many of them are there for the first time. However, this doesn't work as well for community colleges. And that is because of the type of students that are served in different types of institutions. So community colleges tend to serve many more part-time students. Community colleges, outside of dual enrollment and dual credit for high schoolers, which we'll touch on in a bit, outside of that group, they tend to educate an older group of students. So the average age tends to be older. And so those students are more likely to be working. And therefore, they're more likely to be attending school part-time. It also excludes students who've been enrolled in college, other colleges, and many community college students, it's not the first time they've gone to college, right? They may have enrolled in a four-year college and worked successful there, and so then returned to community college at some point, many times, many years later, right? They enrolled as an 18-year-old, weren't successful, and now they're 28, 29 years old back in school. They may have also attended other community colleges over the years. So this cohort definition doesn't do a great job in really capturing who community colleges are serving. The last group that it doesn't do a great job capturing is high school students. And as we'll talk about today, for many community colleges across the 5th District, high school students are a very significant part of who they are now educating. And so these students many times are not categorized as degree seeking. So they are at the colleges, they're enrolled, they're taking courses, but they're not categorized as degree seeking. And they also are less likely to be full-time students. So because of these limitations, the cohorts that are used in IPEDS just don't do as good a job capturing the number of community college students as they do the number of four-year students. And I'm going to show you some data on that first. But before I do that, let me point out how IPEDS has responded to that. They have responded to it. To their credit, they have said, okay, we understand this, so we are going to broaden what we do and include these things they now call outcome measures. Outcome measures, they now have four groups that are captured there. So full-time students who are first-time enrollees, part-time that are first-time, full-time that are non-first-time, and part-time that are non-first-time. So this does a better job widening the cohort, and I'll show you those differences in a second. But this still isn't perfect, and in my views, it still is not sufficient and leaves a gap in data. And the main reason for this is that these measures are not as frequently cited. If you don't know how to navigate IPEDS, these are more difficult to find. So if you think about, if you're trying to find the graduation rate or the outcome rate of how a school is doing, you're just likely to probably pull that graduation rate, not really understanding how the cohort is measured, not really understanding why it doesn't work for community colleges. And it's also not readily understood. It's complicated. You have to go in. You know, I've been an economist, oh gosh, for 15 plus years at this point, and have studied education for almost all of those 15 years. And I still had to go in and really read the data manual to understand what that outcome measure was showing. The other thing is that the outcome measure, what the outcome measure does is it looks at the percentage of people in a broader cohort that received a degree or an award 4, 6, or 8 years out. But it does that over an 8-year time period. So it uses an 8-year cohort. So the most recent data uses a cohort from 2012. That's also problematic because a lot has happened since 2012, as we know. And those of us that either do research in community college on community colleges or work in community colleges, enrollment has changed quite a bit. And so the most recent data, we're looking at people that entered 8 years ago. So there's also some issues there. So I give full credit to IPEDS for stepping up and kind of making these changes, but also realize that there still are some data issues that we think we can address in a separate survey. So this shows how different those cohorts are. So this is for 5th District institutions, and the dark blue bars are the traditional graduation rate cohorts. So that full-time, first-time student. And if you look at this, it looks like private 4-year institutions, public 2-year institutions are not serving very many students in the district. But when you look at that outcome measures cohort, it's much, much larger, right? I mean, it jumps up to being by far, you know, the largest group is the group that are enrolled in these community colleges. And I do think looking at this, I think we have a typo on here. I think on the far left is actually the private 4-year institutions, in the middle is the public 4-year institutions. I apologize for that. But regardless, the main point here is that those public 2-year institutions go from being, you know, that there's only around 60,000 students served to actually there's more like 280,000 students served. And we know that that's actually still not everybody that's being served, because this is just looking at degree seeking students enrolled in 4 credit programs. So this doesn't involve any non-credit students. So it still is a very limited look at who community colleges are serving. Whereas on the 4-year institution side, this is the outcome measures cohort, especially is a more universal look at who they're serving. The other thing we wanted to look at is we wanted to know a bit about how diverse the institutions were. So this uses IPEDS data again, and I'm showing this to you now because I'm going to show you data that we collected in our survey later that's on the same topic. So if you look across the 5th District, with the exception of West Virginia, community colleges serve more Black and Hispanic students than four-year public and private institutions. And I also will point out to you that actually in the 5th District, we have about 31% of all the HBCUs in the United States. So the 5th District, actually the public institutions, which many of the HBCUs, the historically Black colleges and universities, are public institutions. So in North Carolina, for example, you'll see that the number of Black and Hispanic students, or the percentage of Black and Hispanic students in public four-year institutions, is almost as high as public 2 years. But that is skewed by those HBCUs, because many of those in North Carolina, such as North Carolina A&T, Winston-Salem State, schools like that, those schools actually have a good many students that come from out of state to attend those public HBCUs, because so many are in our district. But overall, the two-year schools are more diverse than the four-year schools, public schools. And one of the biggest differences is the income levels of students that are being served at these schools, at community colleges. So this shows, again, IPEDS data that looks at the percentage of students enrolled in credit programs that are recipients of the Pell Grant. And the Pell Grant, of course, is a grant for students who are lower income, who are attending school. And you can see that the gap is really significant. So community colleges, on average, based on IPEDS data, are serving a much lower income population than public four-year institutions. So with that, I'm going to pause there and hand it off to Jason and let him discuss, based on this data, why we decided to do our own survey.
Great. Thanks, Laura. Hi, everyone. I'm Jason Kosakow. I'm the survey director here at the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond. Thank you for taking the time today to walk through these results. The next few slides are going to walk through the methodology and how we got from an idea of collecting information from community colleges about enrollment to actually having data and administering the survey. As always, if you have any thoughts, questions, ideas on how to make this better, or anything along those lines, we're very receptive to all feedback. This is definitely a partnership, and we appreciate all the information that you can provide us. Laura, I think you're in charge of scrolling. Perfect. Great. All right. So how do we currently measure success? And I'm using we and the royal we, as in researchers, academics, legislators, nonprofits, school counselors, students. There are a lot of ways to look at overall outcome metrics for higher education. Laura talked about IPEDS, the IPEDS outcome measures, and there's others. Services out there that provide information. However, they all are very great programs and definitely have a very important purpose. But a lot of them, we just ran into issues where that kind of made us think about, like, do we want to create a new program? For example, like with IPEDS, that's not specifically focused on community colleges, and some of the cohort definitions were kind of out of step with what we had in mind. And also doesn't always capture all the students that we're looking for. So it didn't really, since it was not community college focused, it gave us some issues with data collection. Other issues that we ran into is the data are not public. The National Student Clearinghouse, they have great information at the student level, but we didn't have access to that information. And we wanted a program where we're able to provide information or get information that's publicly available. Some issues is just coverage issues. The National Student Clearinghouse began collecting information on demographics across different states. So that's still in the works, but it's just, there are some coverage issues there. Something else that's important is just the idea of independence. Us as the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond, we don't really have a dog in the fight. We have a hypothesis that community colleges are doing a better job than what they're being given credit for. But that's not what we're trying to prove by collecting this information. We're more on trying to find information, provide us insights. Whereas, for example, the Voluntary Framework of Accountability, which is administered by the American Association of Community Colleges, they're doing something similar that we're trying to do in creating a community college-focused outcome metric program. But what we want to see when we create something is that just a little bit more independence. Because that way, if you're pulling information from them and it looks just really rosy and nice, you know, we want to get rid of the idea that that might come at your head saying, like, oh, well, you know, maybe, you know, the courts are trying to say they're doing better than they are. That's why they're set up. The last line here from the secondary employment outcomes is really interesting and it's still in beta, but this ties majors and to 1, 5, 10 year earnings potential at different quartiles. This is really cool that the census is doing this. And it definitely, when you think about student loan debt, it definitely serves a great purpose, but community colleges do a lot. And just only looking at one metric, like potential earnings, we definitely think it doesn't do a great, does a disservice to community colleges because income is very important. And that's definitely something that should be tracked as just one part of everything this, these schools are doing. So yeah. So going into actually creating a program, we had a couple of goals. So the first thing that was most important is just community college focused. We wanted this program to come from the lens of community colleges. So we did a bunch of cognitive interviews, which we'll get into in the next slide, but we specifically wanted them, the schools themselves, to tell us what success was rather than us trying to put our idea of success on them. And that was the end goal, is that it is specific just for community colleges. Independent, we want people that use this information to trust that the information they're getting is correct and there's no any kind of biases in there. Universally available, eventually we want this information to be similar to like iPads, we can just pull it yourself, not behind any paywalls. Not burdensome, this is really important. There are a lot of you from community colleges on this call. You are asked to pull data for iPads, for your accrediting agency, for your states, for in departments within your institution. There's just a lot of information you're always being asked to pull. And I don't know how you all do it. I'm guessing your research departments just don't sleep, but it's, we didn't want to add another layer of hours and hours and hours of work. So we wanted to create something that was repeatable. So if we ask you to do this next year and the next year and the next year, that you already have the SQL queries or whatever set up. So it's just as little burden added to your plate as well. Longevity is important. We spent a lot of time being very explicit on what we wanted to get out in terms of metrics. We want something similar to iPads where you can pull last year's data, the previous year, and just kind of goes on and on. So that way you can get a longitudinal view of how things are shaping up. And most important, good coverage. Hopefully coming out of this presentation today, you're going to say that this is really interesting work and you want to be a part of it. And we get more and more participants to provide information to us. That way we can provide reliable and good information to those who are interested. So how did we get from an idea all the way to actual data? So some quick background, since Laura came to the Federal Reserve over 3 years ago, she's been talking regularly with community college leaders. So this idea of how community colleges are serving their communities, how they're serving their students, these conversations have been had with Laura and other people within the Federal Reserve System and community colleges. However, when the question was asked, how are community colleges doing overall and you needed specific data, that's when it got a little bit harder. So Laura and I got together and we thought through ways of like, how do we actually get at that? And we came out upon the idea of a survey. So we started off with cognitive interviews with 10 community colleges within our district. 9 out of 10 schools that we talked to, we had an existing relationship with. The reason for that is we have good trust with them and we trust them that they will give us honest feedback. Either like what we're trying to do is just not worth it. It's, you know, we're thinking about it the wrong way. And we would just get really good information just for having a established relationship. So we had these conversations, which eventually led into us going back and forth on creating different metrics, getting feedback in a very iterative process to eventually administering the survey and collecting data. Yeah. So here's what the cognitive interviews look like. Each interview with the 10 schools lasted 90 minutes, and we touched upon a lot of information, but the main goals essentially were, how do community colleges serve their students and their communities? How do community colleges themselves define success and trying to get a better understanding of who's attending their schools? And we did this with the idea that knowing that we're going to derive a set of new outcome metrics from these conversations. So we went into these things knowing and being explicit with the schools and our partners that we're going to eventually want to create a survey. So we want you to come along on this ride with us. And we intentionally talked to a diverse set of schools so we can get a broad range of opinions. The 5th district in itself is very diverse. We have very large urban centers of Washington, D.C., Charlotte. But we also have very rural areas. You think of Appalachia in West Virginia and Western Virginia. We also have very rural areas on the eastern part that are very different than rural Appalachia, like Petersburg. So there are different needs and different ways that these schools are serving their communities just by the students that they do serve. And we didn't want to miss out on getting really valuable information by excluding certain schools. So we talked to 10 schools. We had one in Maryland, two in North Carolina, three in South Carolina, two in Virginia, and two in West Virginia. We had an equal split of rural versus urban. And we had a pretty good split of by school size. So five with fewer than 3,000, three with 9,999. And 10-2 schools with 10,000 or more students. And after the interviews, there's a lot of information to go through. And we sat together and we just worked through all of our notes, and we were able to figure out what the different metrics should look like. And we went back and forth with the schools, trying to be in a very iterative process to get the feedback. Cool. So what we learned from these cognitive interviews were, essentially, publicly available metrics, they don't accurately reflect everything community colleges are doing. And a lot of you on the call are probably thinking, well, you didn't have to have these very in-depth conversations to know that, right? It's like, but it's nice to have that foundation going into our next stage of actually creating a quantitative assessment, knowing this information, putting it on paper and what our mission statement and what our goals are is really important. Something else that's very important to just recognize here is just, community colleges serve very different populations. And often these populations of students are excluded from traditional IPEDS metrics. So the first is credit students. So these are usually included in IPEDS, specifically the outcome measures. So these are students who are getting an associate's degree, or they're in four credit certificate program, or they're getting some sort of credential that's within the credit pipeline. But there's also a lot of non-credit students who are attending community colleges, and they're excluded from IPEDS. So they might be going for workforce credentials, continuing education. An example that I can think of right now is the Community College of Philadelphia is partnering with an organization that trains people on how to get their driver's license to drive commercial vehicles. We have a deficit of commercial drivers, people that can drive 18-wheelers, and Community College of Philadelphia recognizes this, and that's a non-credit program. So everyone would probably agree that the Community College of Philadelphia is doing a service to the community by training people to be able to drive 18-wheelers, but that information wouldn't necessarily be picked up in IPEDS because it's a non-credit program. But what we did find is that many schools are not collecting these data for non-credit students, even though they could make up a really good chunk of the student body. And there's still a lot of open questions on how to best report these data. I have a slide coming up that goes in a little bit more detail about that, but we're open to any idea on how to best collect non-credit information. High school students is often miscounted in IPEDS, and there are some schools that have a very significant proportion of the student body that are derived of high school students. And that is very important if you think about what community colleges are doing. They're training high school students that might not necessarily have an AP math teacher or an AP calculus teacher at their school, but they're able to take AP calculus at a local community college. That's the type of services that they are providing. Lastly is employers who are not counted in IPEDS. We had multiple community colleges within our pilot program that said that they partner with different companies in industry to train them on management techniques, train them how to work an assembly line. And these are very important things, especially state legislators, when they look at what community colleges are doing in terms of workforce development. And having these partnerships with industry is very important. It also shows to legislators and others who might be interested that they're doing a lot more than just teaching students just basic what you might get in a credit program. All right, so what do these new metrics that we're proposing look like? So first for credit students, and so we have a couple different things here. So enrollment, this includes any student enrolled in a credit program. So part-time students and those have previously been enrolled in other programs. So similar to how the outcome measures for IPEDS expanded their definition, this is any student, regardless first time, or if it's their full-time or part-time. We created this metric called the student success metric. It's a good way to have a single number to see how well schools are performing. So this idea is any student who has received an award. So this could be an associate's degree. It could be a licensure. It could be a certificate, a credential, but it shows that they've accomplished something as a success. Or similarly, if they transfer to a four-year institution, that gets considered a success, or if they're currently in good standing. Some students take longer to finish what they need to do. So if they have over 2.0 GPA and have 30 or more credit hours, they're considered in good standing. And when you aggregate, when you count all the students up and you divide them by their total enrollment, that gives you a student success metric. And Laura's going to walk you through what those look like. But we believe that's a pretty good way, or at least a better way, of assessing how well community colleges are serving their credit students. The other things that we look at for credit students, we have total awards granted, total and successful credit hours, and also retention rates. The last two aren't new per se, but the way, just to have an expanded enrollment cohort definition, definitely broadens how many students can be included there. For non-credit students, we're trying to collect enrollment. So all students who are enrolled in the school, but they're not taking any credit classes. So total awards granted. So for the example of Community College of Philadelphia offering CDL training, that would be included there, and total contact hours. So the number of hours students are taking. So on the non-credit, just the call outs, there's a lot of research recently talking about non-credit, and there was recently an article in the Wall Street Journal about this. But non-credit programs vary considerably from institution to institution. And also within the institution, what is non-credit and what gets funded can differ. So we did our best to create the universal non-credit outcome metrics, but we know there could be a lot missing. So, you know, we've heard a lot of, we got a lot of questions when we were in the iterative process of collecting data of what should be included in the non-credit definition. Does it include all programs or just programs fully managed by the institution? Does it only include workforce development programs, or do all programs count? So for example, if you're taking a course in photography or cake decorating, does that count as a success? Should those students be included? And also lastly, what counts as a credential? We'd love to hear all your thoughts on this topic. We are always trying to make this program better. So whatever thoughts you have is definitely appreciated. All right, so for the last metrics here we're collecting, so high school students, as I mentioned before, some of the community colleges serve a lot of high school students, either in early or middle college programs or dual enrollment or dual credit programs. So for high school students, we split them apart by early or middle college programs and dual enrollment, but we're asking for information based on enrollment. So all the high school students who are enrolled in school for early or middle college programs on the total and successful credit hours. So that allows us to look at the percentage of students who had successfully passed their coursework. Just overall total awards granted. So are students getting an associate's degree? Are they getting a licensure? Are they getting a cloud certificate? How are these students being served by community colleges? Lastly here, just industry partnerships. So we just asked very top line, the number of companies they partner with, the number of companies serve, and also just the number of employees from each company they serve. And my last slide here. So what our goal was into this is we knew we weren't going to create the perfect measurement system. And once we acknowledged that, it made this whole program a lot easier. Our goal was to create a system that just better reflects what community colleges are doing. Right? We knew iPads wasn't really it, the way that's currently set up. So we wanted to be able to create a bridge that whoever's interested was able to get the information that we believe better represented the schools as best as we could collect it. We also didn't want to create a long survey. I mean, y'all are very busy already. We don't want to be another, you know, burden on you. So we want to create something repeatable and something that didn't take a lot of time. And in terms of actual collecting the information that Laura's about to walk you through, we administered it via Microsoft Excel. So we had an Excel, Excel document. We sent it off and we provided about a 4-month timeframe between January and April to send that information back. It's a long open time frame intentionally because we knew there's going to be questions. This is the first time. These schools are doing it, so they just need more time. And also for enrollment and outcome metrics, we asked for annual credit students, credit cohort. For non-credit students, we asked for the annual enrollment and information and their and non-credit cohorts. And for high school students, we asked for an annual, and we also asked for industry partnerships. And for the annual enrollment definition, you're about to see the academic year we're considering is 2020 through 2021. So this August 1st, 2020 through July 31st, 2021. And our cohort definitions are they entered the institution during the academic year 2016 to 2017. And we're using a four-year definition. So that's 200% of the normal program completion for an associate's degree. And also there's a question around defining the parameters for good standing. So to be in good standing, you have to have over 2.0 GPA, and you also have to be currently enrolled still, and you also have to have at least 30 credit hours or more completed. And yeah.
All right, thanks so much, Jason. So as you can tell from everything Jason shared, this was quite a process of us like having really about 2.5 years of conversations with community colleges, then leading into the pilot where we had a more intense set of conversations and then developed the survey itself. So I'm gonna go into some of the results. As I've mentioned before, this is just kind of a small peek into the results because this amount of time that we scheduled today seems like a lot, but then it's actually not when you look at all the data that we collected. So more to come in the future there once we broaden the survey. But before we get into the results, I want to level set a little bit. First of all, we highlighted, both Jason and I, some of the issues that exist within the data collection on community colleges. We know that our survey does not fix all of those problems. Like Jason said, once we realized that we couldn't fix all the problems, it really helped us move forward. One of my colleagues always says, the saying, don't let perfect be the enemy of good. And I think that ran through my head a lot during this process. We can still do really good work while not being perfect in this space. So we see this as one small attempt to better measure community college outcomes in the 5th District in a way that we think better serves students, institutions, and the 5th District communities. One thing as a researcher that I feel the need to stress very strongly before I show you these results is that this is a pilot survey with a very small number of observations. So as Jason mentioned, we engaged 10 colleges in the pilot to begin with. We ended up getting data back from 9 of them. So our N equals 9. And if you've taken basic statistics, which probably many people have on this call, is too low of a number of observations to really make allow for substantive analysis. We still think it's worth looking at them, right? We can see some patterns that we think might withstand, hold once we broaden the survey, but I do want to make sure I stress that. In some cases, you're going to see as we go throughout the results that our N is actually even smaller, either because a lack of data availability. So some schools just didn't collect some of the data we were asking for. And then there were a couple instances with particular questions where we felt like the data quality was just not good enough to show that particular school. In those cases, you'll just see things left blank. Future iterations, we hope we will have a much larger N. We hope it's N equals 122 in a wonderful, perfect world, but a much larger N where we can do more in-depth analysis. And like Jason said, build do this annually to where we're collecting a lot of data and can be used from year to year. I will point out to you in the results that follow, we do not show the school names. We have them school 1 through 9, but we did decide to rank them from smallest school to largest school based on the enrollment data that we collected. The reason we wanted to do this is we realized at first we had them in alphabetical order, but as we went through the results, we realized there were some patterns in terms of the size of school, but also maybe the rurality of schools. So as you can imagine, the larger schools tend to be in the more urban areas and the smaller schools tend to be in some of the more rural areas. So I'll try to point out some of those differences as we go through as well. So these are draft results from our pilot survey. So these insights might change, especially as we do the survey again and have a larger set of observations. And I will say that this gets really interesting when you start trying to do data collection across state. For those of you who aren't in the community college space, most states have a community college system, and they have certain data that they collect. And they also have certain ways within states that community colleges are funded. Not surprisingly, some of the data collection matches the funding. So for example, if non-credit is not funded through appropriations from the state, states might not really collect that data. It's not being funded. They're not being asked to collect it. So they might not be collecting it. However, Maryland, they do fund non-credit at par with for-credit programs. Maryland also just made a change where their state scholarships can be used for some non-credit programs. So they do collect non-credit data in a more meaningful way than the other states. So this gets interesting when we start to do it across states, but we tried to use definitions that we believed were kind of universal and everybody could collect. We knew that the data on non-credit programs were not commonly reported and in some of our states not commonly collected. We learned that very early on through our cognitive interviews. And so we knew that it was going to be difficult to collect those data. However, I will be transparent in telling you that it was much more difficult than we even anticipated. There are some schools that cannot tell us how many students they are serving in non-credit programs. This does not mean the schools don't value these programs. In many cases, these programs generate a lot of income and revenue for schools. It's just they're not collecting the data in the same data management systems. And so there are some schools in our district that do some non-credit enrollment through things like Eventbrite and other websites where they're not collecting data on students. They're not collecting demographic data. They're not collecting gender or income or things like that. And like I said, some other schools collect a pretty rigorous amount or high level of non-credit data. I think what we've also learned so far in our evaluation of currently available data is that the current data collection methods don't capture community college success rates in a meaningful way. This is risky for schools, I think. You know, as a researcher, as an economist, but also as a long-term educator myself, I know as a public educator, you have this need to kind of constantly justify how you're doing things and how you're serving your students. And it's difficult to prove your effectiveness if the data that are being publicly reported by outside organizations are not showing what really the rate of success you think you have with your students. And this is also true when trying to gain additional funding, right? I mean, I think those graphs I showed in the beginning that show the gap in the graduation rates between four-year schools and two-year schools, you can imagine being a legislator and looking at those graphs and thinking, you know, if we have another dollar to put forward, should we put it in the two-year community college system versus the four-year more traditional higher ed system? You could see people making decisions that way. So we believe that as a nonpartisan, independent, third-party research organization, like Jason said, we don't really have a dog in this fight, right? We are trying to look at how our schools are serving communities, and that is the students in those communities, and also the companies in those communities, and thirdly, the companies that might come to those communities, right, through economic development. We believe that we can be a value add in providing data that is similar to some other data that are collected, but maybe look at it through a slightly different lens to show community college success. Okay, so the first thing I'm gonna show you is some enrollment data. How our survey differs from IPEDS, from the results we got so far. And you'll see at the bottom here, school one to school nine. And once again, those are done by size. So the smallest schools are schools one, smallest school is school one, largest school is school nine. We found that our survey results show that IPEDS is undercounting certain student populations, one of which are Black students. And so this graph shows Black student population. So in order to compare Black enrollment to the Black populations in the county served by these pilot community colleges, we created these weighted averages of, so the gray bar that you see there is the percentage of people in the county served by the community colleges, what percentage of those counties' residents are Black, okay? The dark blue is what we have in our survey as the total percentage of students being served that are Black in credit programs. And the lighter blue is IPEDS. A couple things that you'll notice is that the pilot survey, our pilot survey results universally across all nine schools showed that schools were serving a higher percentage of Black students than was indicated in IPEDS. once again, our view of who is counted basically is broader than iPads. And so that's part of why it would be different. Another thing I want to point out, and this is going to be important throughout, is that we are not comparing apples to apples because of data differences with years. And I'll point that out shortly in a minute as well. But our data uses the 2020-2021 school year. iPads uses the most recent enrollment we can get is fall 2020. So it's a different viewpoint, right? But for comparison's sake, we'll compare it here. But we are showing in our results that schools are showing a larger share of Black students than iPads is showing. And actually, one thing that we found really interesting was, you know, in the case of if you look at like school 3, school 7, really school 1, school 5 for sure, what we found in our survey was that the schools were actually serving the proportion of students they were serving that were Black was actually very similar to that in the communities in which they serve. Which we find important because, as we mentioned, in general, four-year schools are serving a less diverse population. And so we think that maybe the diversity of the two-year schools is underreported in iPads. The second thing, though, that we looked at was Pell Grant status. Now, this is kind of the opposite. I showed you in the beginning that the percentage of students that receive the Pell Grant is much larger at community colleges than it is four-year schools. But in our survey, we actually found that the percentages of students who were receiving the Pell Grant was lower in all cases than what was reported by iPads. What is this driven by? This is driven by, I think, mainly the fact that we are counting high school students. Okay, so our definition of who counts as enrollment in enrollment, as Jason mentioned, is essentially everyone that is degree seeking. That's part-time, full-time, first-time, non-first-time, and then also all high school students that are being served. The high school students are much less likely to be receiving the Pell Grant. In fact, they're very unlikely to be receiving the Pell Grant. But we think this gives a better view potentially of, you know, if a school is serving a large percentage of high school students and none of them are receiving Pell, then that's important to reflect in some of the data as well. As we move forward in the survey, we'll be able to separate out the high school students from the non-high school students to show this at further broken down. But for now, this is what we'll see here. So one of the most significant differences in our survey is the cohort definition. And we've already talked about this a bit, but I'm going to spell this out really specifically because I'm going to show you the data based on the cohorts. And it's important for you to understand these cohorts more. And I will acknowledge that this can be so confusing. I think Jason and myself and Jacob Walker, who you'll meet during the Q&A portion today, I bet we have gone in and looked at these definitions ourselves 100 different times to make sure we are looking at what we think we're looking at. So the iPads graduation cohort, the traditional iPads, when you see iPads graduation rate, the cohort that they are using is first-time, full-time degree or certificate-seeking students enrolled in credit programs, so all credit, and they use 150% time to completion metric. That's their traditional metric. They have others as well, but that's the one that we're going to focus on. So their most recent data, which is from fall 2020, uses a cohort that entered in fall 2017. Okay, so it's 150% of time, and since what we're looking at is associate's degrees, it's a three-year window. Okay, so when I show you iPad's graduation date, rate data, that is from students who entered in fall 2017. The iPads outcome measure cohort broadens that, as we mentioned. And so it looks at both part-time and full-time degree and certificate seeking students measured in a full year cohort. And that includes first-time students, so students who enrolled in college for the first time, and non-first-time students. So they look at what percentage of those students had a degree, finished their degree, four, six, or 8 years after graduation. But to do this, they use a cohort of students that entered 8 years ago. So the most recent data we have on iPads outcome measures is from a cohort that entered between July 1st, 2012 and June 30th, 2013. Okay. Our cohort is even a little more different. Okay, so ours looks at everybody that entered the institution seeking either a degree a certificate or a licensure. So we add in licensure there. And all high school students taking courses for credit. And we measured, we decided to use a 200% time to associates window. So we use a four-year cohort. So our survey uses a cohort of people that entered during the 2016-17 school year. Okay. So as I show you the data from these cohorts, it is really important to realize that we're not looking at the same group of students, right? One is students that entered in 2017, one is students in 2012, one is students in 2016. So it's not comparing apples to apples. Well, it might be like comparing a type of apple to another type of apple, but not the same apple. So just keep that in mind as we look through here. I think it's still valuable to compare them because if one of these measures is consistently larger than the others, that might tell us something, right? We realize that to know for sure, we're going to have a multi-year panel of our survey with a much larger N, right? A much larger number of observations to know for sure. So the first thing I'm going to show you is the cohort size differences. So I showed you in an earlier slide for all 5th district schools, the difference between the IPEDS graduation rate cohort and the outcome measure cohort. And you saw they were really significant. But what now you can see as well is our cohort. So the traditional IPEDS cohort is the light blue dot. The gray dot is the outcome measure cohort. So those two numbers are pulled from IPEDS, from the most recent IPEDS edition. And then the blue dot is our cohort. Couple things you'll notice here is in most cases, the Richmond Fed cohort is significantly larger than the other cohorts. However, for the two smallest schools, that's not the case. Now here, it's difficult to know if that is because of the differences in years. So for example, if we look at school one, that outcome measure outcome cohort being larger might be because there's been enrollment decline since 2012 at that school, right? That might be part of it. We'll have to work through this with some other iterations to figure out exactly why. But one thing you will notice is that at some of the larger schools, our cohort is really much, much larger. So as schools get bigger, that gap between kind of the IPEDS cohort and our cohort grows. And I think that's because if you think about urban schools, they're more likely to have people that maybe attend part-time, right? Attend after work or it's not the first time they've gone to school. You know, they went to another school and now they've moved to town, to a city, they're working and they're going to the community college to take some classes. It also may be that those schools serve more high school students through large dual enrollment, dual credit programs, which I'll talk about in a minute. But across the board, for the schools that were larger, our cohort is significantly bigger. So then we take this cohort and we say, okay, what percentage of these students in the cohort were successful? And Jason mentioned this again before, but I'm going to go through it again because this is really important. We decided that just looking at who graduated was insufficient for success in terms of completions. We decided to also include people who attained a credential or a licensure, so a workforce credential or a licensure. Why did we find this important? I'll be honest, part of this was from my experience in higher ed, and some of it was from all the conversations we've had with schools. What we heard from a lot of schools was that it's common for people to leave before they finish because they've gotten a job. So let's say somebody comes in and they want to get an associate's degree to be a mechanic, but they get through the program and they get certification in one particular thing. And a company says, oh, you're certified in that one thing. We'll hire you right now. You don't need that associate's degree. And they leave. Well, it's hard to label that as a failure, right? They got that credential at the community college. They were able to get the job that they were seeking, right? Or one in the field that they wanted to work in. And so we decided that that should be labeled as a success. I also found that this was important from my work in higher ed, which was because I had the knowledge that really a lot of higher education organizations, and this is two-year schools and four-year schools, are really moving forward with the idea of stackable credentials. What does this mean? This means that instead of having kind of a traditional degree, you might have 4 or 5 stackable credentials where if you get these 5 credentials, that actually turns out to be an associate's degree or it turns out to be a certificate degree. One of the outcomes from that process, if schools move forward from that, is going to be that less people graduate potentially, right? Because you're giving them these credentials midway through or a quarter way through the program. And so they may leave to go take a job that they now qualify for based on that credential. I don't necessarily think that should be viewed. You know, research will need to be done to show whether or not that's a good thing or not. But for now, we decided to count workforce credentials and licensures as successes. So we take the percent that either graduated from their degree program or certificate program or attained another credential or license, and we add that to the percent that transfer. Now, this is something you kind of commonly see in community college research, is you'll see the graduation plus transfer rate. So this is similar, except we're also adding in these people that get a credential or licensure. But we also decided to add in people that are persisting. So what do we mean by this? Jason already defined it as those that have over 30 credit hours and have at least a 2.0. So in our measure, these are people that are still enrolled in their program 4 years after starting, who have at least 30 credit hours, and they have good standing in terms of GPA. What we found is when we started collecting these data, and I'm going to show it to you in just a second, there's actually a pretty large percentage of these folks that are taking one class a semester to graduate. Maybe every now and then they take two classes. And these students tend to be older students. They tend to be women. They tend to be women with children who are working, who are just kind of going slow, but they're still progressing. So once again, we didn't feel like they should be left out of looking at the success rate of a community college. So we measure this 4 years after they've entered school. And here are our results. So let me describe what you're looking at here. So the blue dot is the traditional IPES graduation rate. The gray dot is that outcome measure graduation rate. So that broadens it. So again, the light blue dot is looking at just full-time, first-time students. The gray dot is adding in part-time students and non-first-time students. Let me pause for a second and say that broadening a cohort does not necessarily mean you're going to get a higher graduation rate, right? Because as you broaden that cohort from full-time, first-time students to part-time, non-first-time students, you might be broadening it to a group that is less likely to succeed, right? You might say people that are enrolled full-time, maybe they're more likely to be heavily invested in the program, right? Maybe they're less likely to be working and can put all their energy into the program. So maybe adding part-time students doesn't give you a higher graduation rate, right? In some cases, though, you might say, well, people who haven't attended first time aren't attending first time. They have some experience, right? They experienced college before. Now they've re-enrolled. Maybe they're more serious this time. Maybe they're going to have a higher success rate. So it's uncertain, right? So I do want to point out, though, that it doesn't necessarily mean that that blue dot should be lower than the gray dot. And you'll see in a lot of cases it's not. The dark blue dot is our success rate. And you will see that in most cases, it is higher than the gray or blue dot. Once again, it's hard to know why, it's hard to know for sure until we do this again and until we have a larger number of observations exactly how consistent this will be, but we did find that in most cases, our success rate was higher than what it was shown in IPEDS. And in some cases, especially for school 7, school 5 that you'll see there, school 4, when you're comparing it to the traditional graduation rate, it was significantly higher. For school 9, I will point out there that it turns out that the IPEDS rate, the traditional graduation rate and the outcome measure rate are basically identical. So that's why you can't see the two dots, but they are there. So here's a breakdown of that success metric for the schools. So this shows what percentage of students got a degree or credential or licensure, and then what percentage transferred and what percentage persisted. Few things I notice here right from the start, and this is an example of one of the times when we broke it down when we decided to break it down by size of school. The first thing you'll notice is that the larger schools are having a lot more students that transfer. This is not really very surprising because this is something you'll see as a pattern across the country, right, that a lot of the larger community colleges really do serve as very strong transfer pipelines to the largest universities across the state. And so you'll see at the smaller community colleges, which in this case do tend to be the more rural schools, they're doing a lot less transfer work, right? They're having a lot fewer students transfer, and a larger percentage of their students are graduating or getting a credential. However, you'll see at those smaller schools, they have a larger percentage that are persisting, right? That are attending very part-time most likely, and that are kind of slowly but surely getting that credential or that degree. And so I think, you know, when we looked at this and saw, with the exception of school three, when we saw the percentage of students that were in that persisted category, it made us even more confident that we should be including them as students that are successful at community colleges. So I mentioned this already, but we knew going into this that non-credit was going to be messy and not fully available. I will say that our pilot schools were really great about this. Even the schools that knew they didn't have the data said, please still ask us the questions. We want to be able to do this better. And so we did ask the questions, and we will confess that the data quality was worse than we expected. Many schools that we talked to only had top level data available, so they could just tell you kind of the total number of students served. Some had no data available at all. They weren't even able to tell us that. Only one pilot school collects non-credit data identically to how credit data are collected. The others use a different system or are not collecting full data on non-credit students as they do credit. And as I mentioned before, this is highly dependent on what state it's in, and in my opinion, how they're funded. If non-credit programs are fully funded and they're getting appropriations based on headcount data or FTE data, then they're collecting the data in a better way than the states where that funding via appropriations doesn't exist. All the schools that we talked to acknowledge that data collection for non-credit courses and students is an issue in the community college space. And IPEDS has announced that they're going to start collecting these data in 2025. And so this is something that schools are going to have to work towards. And so schools acknowledge that they wish they could collect more data in this space. So here, you know, we were able to get at least some non-credit data from 7 of our 9 schools. And the thing I'll just point out here is that, so this is the size of the credit cohort versus the size of the non-credit cohort. So the non-credit cohort is similar in that it's just all the students that are enrolled in 2016, 2017 in these non-credit programs. The one conclusion that I think is clear that we can make is that not counting non-credit students is significantly limiting the story that you can tell about these community colleges, because a large percentage of their students are in non-credit programs. Not as much so for the very smallest schools in our survey, but certainly for the larger schools. And you can see that in 2 of our schools, school 5 and school 9, actually the majority of their students, of the students that were included in the cohorts, were on the non-credit side. For those of you that aren't from community colleges or don't work in that space, non-credit programs historically have been more like continuing education programs. So Jason mentioned things like photography or bird watching, things like that, cake decorating. Now, you could argue that those are still job creation programs too, right? I could take a cake decorating course and start a business doing cake decorating, but they're not traditional workforce programs. However, over time, that has changed, and there are a lot of short-term non-credit programs that really are workforce programs. So things like commercial driver's license programs, things like phlebotomy at many of the schools in our district, things like pharmaceutical technician, some of the nursing degrees, like the nursing assistant degrees, things like that. Those programs in general are not eligible for the same type of funding, either at the school level with appropriations, as I already mentioned, or at the student level. So for example, you can't use the Pell Grant or federal financial aid for those programs. So schools and within states and across states make decisions on where programs are based on this, right? If you're in a state that doesn't heavily fund non-credit programs, you might be more likely to put a program on the for-credit side. What is the negative side of that? Is that if it's on the for-credit side, there are more rules about general education courses that must be taken, how long the program has to be, things like that. So it might be faster to put those workforce programs on the non-credit side, but for funding reasons, they might put it on the for-credit side. So I explained some of that because, as we know, these are schools across five different states. And so right now, the way that schools are funded and the way that data are collected, there are some states where that incentive to put programs on the four credit side is larger than others. But regardless of that, I think it's clear that not counting these non-credit students is really undercounting the service that community colleges are doing for communities, and especially for companies, because many of the programs that we hear talked about in the news and, you know, shortages of certain trades, many of those are done on the non-credit side. Another thing we wanted to look at was gender. So, you know, as I said, we're just showing you a small piece of everything we collected here just for time's sake, but we did collect full demographic data on four credit students and non-credit students when available. And one of the things we saw, and not surprising, the four credit side and higher ed in general now is predominantly female, right? On the credit side, you can see here that some of the students, some of the schools even are greater than 70% female on the credit side. But one thing we saw, this is the percentage of men across enrollment type. And at most of the schools, a larger number of men are served on the non-credit side because of the types of programs that they have. And this is especially true at schools 2, 5, and 7. And so not counting non-credit students also undercounts the number of men that are served by community colleges. And this is a topic that really gets a lot of attention in higher ed in general, right? The decline in male enrollment and how many more females are being served by higher ed institutions. But I do think in some ways that might be undercounted by the way in which we're counting credit and non-credit programs. Oops. So data on high school students. This is something we felt really convicted about after speaking to a lot of you guys that are on this call and other community colleges as well. Many of our district community colleges are serving large numbers of high schoolers. So during the 2020-21 school year, our 9 schools in our pilot served over 11,000 high school students, which is really just an incredible number of students to be served. Only one school served very few. And you'll see these in a second. 3 serve more than 2,000, and some rural schools are serving greater than 1,000 high school students annually. And high school students accounted for more than 35% of total credit enrollment at some pilot schools. So not counting them or just explaining how successful are these students? Are they getting degrees? Are they getting certificates? Leaving them out in a very specific way is also, I think, limiting the view of what community colleges are doing. And what we found in our pilot is that these high school students are remarkably successful in their courses. So we looked at what percentage of courses were completed successfully. And for high school students, 87.4% of credit hours that were attempted were earned successfully. And the same rate for all credit courses was 77.8%. So they were remarkably successful. And then also we found, degree attainment, getting an associate's degree might not be the goal of many of these high school students. But we found that across our 9 schools, they issued 949 degree certificates and licensures to high school students during the last year's school year, which is a significant number, right? This is a significant number of students that are across 9 schools that graduated with some sort of credential. So what this slide shows is the number of high school students that were served at our pilot schools last year during the 2020-21 school year. Then the middle column shows the percent that those students represent in terms of percent of total credit students. And then on the far right, we have the percentage of credit hours that those credit hours that high schoolers took that were completed successfully. I'm not going to talk a lot about that far right column, but I will point out, like I just said a second ago, that rate was really high. I mean, these high school students are quite successful in their attainment of the credit hours that they attempt. But if we look on the far right and the second column, I guess, and then the third column, we see that there are a lot of high schoolers that are being served across these 9 pilot schools. With the exception of one that just serves at Levin, all the rest of them are serving more than 500 high school students last year. And for our rural schools, if you look at the column there of the percent of total credit enrollment, the rural schools 2 through 5, all of those are rural. Those are the 5 highest our four highest percentages we see out of all the non-pilot schools. So rural schools are serving a large percentage of a large number of high school students that makes up a reasonably large percentage of their total credit enrollment. This really makes sense, especially after speaking to a lot of these schools and talking to schools across the 5th District. If you think about rural places and towns where you would have smaller community colleges, you also have smaller, sometimes less resourced K through 12 systems. And so it may be difficult for them to recruit, for example, an AP biology teacher or an AP calculus teacher, AP English, or maybe even they may be too small to have an international baccalaureate program. So instead of offering AP courses or having IB courses, they might offer community college courses either at the high school through a dual credit program or allow students to go to the community college campus for dual enrollment. We also have a significant number of early and middle colleges across the district where there are particular high schools where students go to high school, oftentimes on a community college campus to take community college classes that also give them high school credit. And many of these students are working towards an associate's degree while they're in high school. Additionally, if you look towards the, you know, schools 7, 8, and 9, you see that they serve over 2,000 high schoolers each, but it makes up a smaller percentage of their total credit enrollment, right? But at bigger places too, more urban schools, we are seeing dual credit and dual enrollment programs growing. And some of that is because these students, they're achieving, right? They're getting these college credits that they're going after. And in some cases, they can do it at no cost to themselves because the school district is paying for it or the state is paying for it through appropriations. So, you know, at some large high schools, they might have AP courses and IB courses available to them. But some students, and there's actually a bit written about this out in kind of the popular press about how some high school students really prefer dual credit, dual enrollment courses, because with AP or IB, you've got to take the course. Oftentimes it lasts the entire year. Then you've got to take a test, right? Unless you get AP, you know, 3, 4, or 5, and depending on where you go to school, they might require a 4 or a 5 to get credit. However, if you do dual enrollment, dual credit, and you pass the course, if you're going to a public university in the state, oftentimes there's guaranteed transfer, right, for these community college courses. And so students don't have to worry about taking a test after completing the course. So a lot of students really, really do prefer dual enrollment, dual credit. We feel like this is really a big value add for our survey. There are not a lot of data out there that show much about these high school students that are being served by community colleges. We especially think it's important because it is such a significant part of what community colleges are doing now in 2022, and that will likely continue beyond. And honestly, as I've talked to people that aren't as familiar with the community college system, this is something a lot of people are not aware of. They might have heard of dual enrollment, dual credit. They may, you know, have a neighbor or a friend or a cousin or something that participated in it, but they do not realize that there are schools in the 5th District. There are some schools in our district that more than 50% of their students are high schoolers. And so we felt like it was important to break those data out and get more specific information on them. In addition, we do break it out between early and middle college students. So these students that are attending special high schools that are focused on these students getting community college credits, and then regular kind of dual enrollment, dual credit programs. We think that's important too, to cut so that we can kind of compare and contrast the success rates that these students are having. Maybe there is a benefit to attending a separate high school that is really focused on this. Maybe there's not. We don't really know. So this will allow us to conduct research on that topic as well. Here's an example of one of those demographics. One of the things that is a criticism of dual credit, dual enrollment, and it's a criticism of FAPIB as well, is that minority students are less likely to be engaged in those courses. And so we looked at what was the percentage of white students across enrollment categories. So we have non-credit, for credit, and then dual enrollment. Dual enrollment is the blue line, and we did see that there was a higher percentage in most cases. There was a higher percentage of white students in the dual enrollment, dual credit courses than in the other types of coursework. In the way we did it in the pilot, we weren't able to separate out the dual enrollment, dual credit from the credit. So let me restate that. So if you look at this, non-credit is separate, but the dual enrollment dual credit students are also part of the credit students. So they're part of that group as well. But you can see that in most cases, the light blue line is above the darker blue line. So I think this is something that we'll look more closely into as well as we expand our number of observations. Okay, a couple other things. I know we've been on here for a while now, so hang with me for a couple more slides, and then we'll move on to our next, our plans going forward and to Q&A. There's a lot of questions in here, but if you have questions, please do put them in there. So one of the other things we wanted to ask community colleges about was wraparound services. These came up a lot in our conversations. We heard a lot about the need for wraparound services. And sometimes difficulties in providing some wraparound services because the funding wasn't necessarily there for some of these. And so we asked colleges, did they provide the following services that you see here? So mental health counseling, academic counselors, on-site food pantries, public transportation, on-site counseling for social services, so things like SNAP benefits and TANF, on-site cafeteria, on-site childcare, and on-site health services. And what we found is while some things like academic counselors and mental health counseling was almost universally provided, other things such as childcare and health services were not provided at all in the case of health services, and much less frequently provided in terms of childcare. From a research perspective, we are interested to see if these wraparound services matter. And to know if they matter, we have to collect data on them to then, you know, over time, if we collect a panel, we can see, right, when schools added a wraparound service, did it impact enrollment? If the fact that they don't have it, does that impact their enrollment? Does it impact the type of students that they're recruiting? Things like that. So we think this could be really valuable data to use for research purposes going forward. And so that schools maybe can lobby for certain things, you know, maybe this would help schools if they don't currently have an on-site food pantry to say, hey, a large percentage of community colleges are offering this service. This is something we think we need. And here's some data actually showing that that is being offered frequently. And then the last thing, Jason mentioned this before about looking at how schools are serving companies in the area. This also came up a lot in our conversations, and we thought there should be data on this as well. So we did hear from a lot of the community colleges we talked to that they were serving local companies directly. And, you know, this is a really important, I personally have been involved in a lot of economic development efforts in my prior job over the years and have served on a lot of committees. And I know that these types of questions are asked, right? What kind of corporate training is available in the area? What do community colleges offer in terms of this? And it also can represent a very significant source of revenue for schools. They're able to charge for these services on the non-credit side of the house and make a lot of money in some cases. Surprisingly, some of the schools in our pilot are doing this, but are not collecting any data on it. Once again, if there's not funding for certain programs, it does make sense that maybe you wouldn't collect data because you're not reporting it anywhere. But 6 of our 9 could provide us some data on the number of companies and employees served. Those 6 schools reported a number of companies that range from 4 all the way to 392 companies, and a number of employees that range from 98 to 2,528. I will say as we move forward, we want to encourage district community colleges to collect and report these data. And we hope that the fact that we're going to collect and report them, encourage them to collect it so that we can be, you know, more fully tell this story, because we do think this is an important piece of the puzzle as well. So that was a lot for me to throw in there, but like I said, not near as much as I would like to show you. But let me go through pretty quickly kind of a summary and then our future plans, and then we'll open up for questions. So to summarize, there's no doubt to anybody on this team or probably on this call that community colleges play a really important role in communities. And this is both in terms of educating people and providing an education service, but also on the economic development front. The data on community colleges are complicated. And most of this is because the data collection metrics were not built with community colleges in mind. They were built with four-year schools in mind. And so it's kind of like, you know, trying to force a square peg into a round hole. And these data systems too and data collection are limited in a way that proves frustrating to the colleges themselves, researchers, companies, and communities. You know, if I talk to departments of commerce across the states, they wish they had better data on community colleges. If I talk to economic developers, they say the same thing. If I talk to companies, they say the same thing. We're saying the same thing as researchers, and we're hearing the same thing from colleges as well. So our survey provides a new way to measure outcomes of students and also provides data on non-credit programs, the service to high schoolers, wraparound services, and corporate training. And those last three, we have not been able to find a place that it kind of rolls all of that together in one data product. And so we believe this is just a more holistic view way to look at community college success. And it is important when telling the story about how these schools are serving their community, especially because it looks so different in so many different places, right? So there are some community colleges that aren't doing much dual enrollment, dual credit, but are doing a lot of corporate training. There are some that are providing a pipeline through transfer that is the major pipeline, the primary pipeline for transfer within their states. There are others that are doing a great job educating the local people in their town and providing those people with credentials and degrees. So it differs based on the locations of these schools, the companies in the counties they're serving, the types of communities they serve in the states that they're in. And so we believe that the more holistic view does a better job of explaining all of that. And so we look forward to broadening our list of survey participants so that we can publish full results next year so you can see all of it and broken down by demographics as well. So we want survey participants. That is a big message that we want to share here. I mean, I said jokingly before, but I don't mean it jokingly. I would love to have all 122. I would love to see this survey be something that the system offices decide is important for the schools in their states and join in with. But we also would encourage individual schools now to sign up if you're interested in participating. We have this great QR code that'll take you directly to a website where you can sign up to be a part of our next survey panel. Our goal is to build a long-term panel of fifth district community colleges so that we can look at both short-term and long-term outcomes and enrollment. So we have a long-term goal in mind here. So you can scan that QR code there to join the panel, or you can also reach out to myself or Jason. And I'll give you our next steps in terms of our timeline. This summer, we're continuing conversations. Many of you on this call have spoken to us already. We are so grateful for your time and attention. We cannot even express how valuable that has been. And not only that, but Jason and Jacob and I have joked around about this a lot, but it's so true. We enjoy these conversations so much. We have found the community college research space to be just extraordinarily congenial. Like people are everybody's trying to do the same thing, right? Everybody wants better data. Everybody wants to improve how things are measured. And so that's been really great. So if you'd like to talk to us, please do reach out. We're going to also continue to edit our survey document and tool. There are certain things, like the thing I pointed out to you, that I'd like to be able to break out certain demographics by, like take the dual enrollment, dual credit students out of the credit metric. There are things like that, that edits we need to make to document before the next round. But our plan is this fall to go live with our second survey. So we would like to expand to as many colleges as possible this fall. And then in spring 2023, be able to release a first full set of survey results. And then next summer, we would like to be able to host an event, like in-person event for community college researchers and community colleges themselves. We're open to ideas about how to bring that together, but we have learned as we've talked about this, that there's also just a lot of value in information sharing. You know, schools in South Carolina don't necessarily know how things are working in Virginia or Maryland, right? And so just sharing information across states, we believe to be a valuable outcome of this as well. So here are our contact information. We'll show you this again also at the end of the event today after the Q&A. We want you to contact us and tell us what you think. Feedback is great. Questions are great. I know there's already a lot of them in the Q&A, so I'm excited to get to those in just a second. But we truly mean it when we say we would like your feedback on what you heard today, what you saw today. We are truly trying to just play a small role in improving some of the data that we believe out there and providing a different lens through which some research can be done, but also community colleges can use that data to show how they're serving their communities. So I'm going to stop sharing now, and we will go to Q&A with Jacob and Jason.
All right, as Laura mentioned, we are going to go into the Q&A. So if you have any questions, put them in the chat. And I guess we'll just go ahead and jump in. The first question I want to go over is in regards to the Pell Grant comparison chart. So this attendee says, unless a school is participating in a Pell Grant for dual enrollment / concurrent enrollment pilot, high school students are ineligible for financial aid, including Pell. Why would they be included in numbers related to students receiving Pell?
Yeah, I can answer that for sure. So I think it's important for it to be reported both ways. So I think it's important to report the overall percentage of students at the university or college that are receiving Pell, and then the percentage of non-dual enrollment, dual credit that are receiving Pell. Why do I think they should be included in part of it? I think it gives a better view in some ways of all the students who are being served, right? So let me give you two points of view. You could have one school that is serving a very high percentage of Pell Grant students and very few dual enrollment students. And so a very high percentage of their funding might be coming from the Pell Grant, okay? And if you look at the percentage of funding from the Pell Grant, there's some schools in our district that are quite high. However, you could have another school that has that where their traditional credit students typically are lower income and are Pell, but then they're serving a large percentage of dual credit, dual enrollment students. And that funding might be coming from a different source, right? Depends on what state you're in, but it might be coming from the state government directly. It might be coming from parents directly. It might be coming from school districts or a combination of all three of those things. I think that that is important when looking at kind of the financial health of the university and the financial sources that they're dealing with. And so I do think it's important to include them in a metric. I don't think that should be the only metric. But I do think it is an important metric to look at. All the students who are at the school who are enrolled in four credit programs, what percentage of them are receiving the Pell Grant?
All right, thank you for that, Laura. Another question we got was, are we capturing the program of study in the survey? So what I'm assuming that means like what programs students are enrolled in, or is it just more broad-based?
We're not capturing the program of study. The reason behind that is there are so many different programs that could be captured. And especially if we're trying to our goal wasn't trying to create something that would take hours and hours to do. So we try to keep it more topical. I think in a perfect world, like having that kind of information would be fantastic. But our goal was just to create more top line measures. So maybe in a future iteration, if that is not like the most burdensome thing to do to pull that information, we'll be happy to collect it and report on that. But right now we're just looking at the top line metrics and not programs to study.
Yeah, I think this is something that has been interesting, you know, for me. So Jason is our survey director at the Federal Bank of Richmond, and I, you know, I'm an economist. And so as an economist, like I want all the data, right? I want to be able to explain everything. And you know, Jason did a really good job of constantly reminding me too that we can't be overly burdensome, because these institutions and the people doing this are already overly burdened in a lot of cases. And I think our conversations did prove that was the case. And so I think in the future, there's all sorts of opportunities for what we could collect. We could include some special questions each year, you know, to measure what's going on in communities and things like that. But right now we decided not to do specific program questions.
All right. And the next question is, can you clarify who completes the survey at the colleges? Was it the IR office?
Yes, we initially, when we had those interviews, those in-depth interviews with the colleges, we met with the presidents and the folks from the IR office. But the data itself was provided by the IR. It stands for Institutional Research, for folks that aren't familiar with that. But so the data itself came from the institutional research office.
Hey, Laura, what about the non-credit information? That is not necessarily.
Yeah. Great. That's a great question, Jason. Oftentimes the non-credit data are collected. So they call them sides of the house. So there's the credit side of the house and the non-credit side of the house. Sometimes the IR office is just on the credit side of the house. So they have to go to the non-credit side to get that data. Which was part of the reason why that could be a much messier process. because it's not in the system that the IR office is using day in and day out.
All right, fantastic. So another question we have is, if a school chooses to participate, will identified data be shared with the participating schools? For example, if XYZ Community College sends data, will XYZ Community College receive a report showing where it ranks among participants, or will it all be de-identified?
So we de-identified it this time because in the beginning we decided not to identify in the pilot. However, our goal going forward is to identify. Our goal going forward is for it to be where schools' data can be pulled, like it is in iPads or something else, so that, you know, in other data sources, so that you can see it by school. That is our goal. I think that's something, though, that we're going to have to talk to schools about, exactly how, you know, I think one of the things we'll do this fall for sure before we do the next round is to have a conversation with all the IR institutional research folks that are going to be collecting the data to see how they feel about that. But from a research point of view, we would love it to be where, because we want this to be able to be used by communities too. We want it to where, you know, if a company is looking to locate in Charleston, South Carolina, they can pop on and pull Trident Technical College's data and see what it looks like. We want it to be able to be useful to a broader set of people. So I think identifying is important in that regard. You want to add anything there, Jason?
Yeah, the other thing to keep in mind is we only have 9 schools. If we can get a larger sample size, like as close to universal coverage as possible, we'd be able to release reports at the state level. So right. If you are a rural school in South Carolina, you can look at how you compare. You get a report with how you compare with South Carolina, and also we can pull rural schools from other parts of our district to make comparisons against. But we would just need to have a large enough sample where it's not easily to be able to identify who that school is yet. So definitely, I love that idea. It's a great suggestion, and if it encourages people to participate, knowing that they'll get more institutional knowledge about what the community college space looks like, we're happy to provide that kind of content.
Fantastic. And another question we got is, are there other Fed districts that are doing similar type studies with community colleges?
Not that we know of. We've talked to a lot of folks, and we have not heard of any other Federal Reserve banks across the district that are across the system that are doing a similar product.
Okay. Another question we have we have the data divided by rural and urban. Well, we have schools that are in rural and urban areas. So what are some patterns that you're seeing among rural schools versus urban schools?
Yeah. You know, that's been one of the more interesting parts, I think, of the conversations we had for Jason and I, was to just learn more about how the schools operate. And the more rural schools are different than the more urban schools, right? The more urban schools, we have some huge community colleges in our district, and these large community colleges, they are serving a lot of transfer students, as we saw, our students that plan to transfer. So students who come in with the express goal of doing a year or two at the community college and then to go on to a 4-year institution. They also have a lot of folks that are working and attend community college in the evening. So, you know, some people attend community college where they live, but a lot of people attend community college where they work, right? Well, that makes sense too, right? If you're a working adult, that you might want to kind of go right after work to a class. The rural schools, they tend to operate very differently because they're serving a very different type of community, right? There are some, a lot of the rural community colleges that we talk to tend to have large healthcare programs. So they serve a lot of students who are trying to study healthcare fields because that's what a lot of the jobs are centered around in those rural communities. They also do a lot less transfer because there's less likely to be a large 4-year college in that town, right? Or really close by. So they do less of the 4-year transfer. I do think we're going to see in the long run some differences too in terms of the dual enrollment, dual credit story. And I think there's a lot of research to be done in that field. You know, I think there's one line of thinking where you could say it's really awesome that these schools are doing this because the K-12 district can't maybe serve students in the full, you know, in the way that they want to in rural districts. There's another line of thinking, too, where some people would say, yeah, but they shouldn't be outsourcing it to these community colleges. They should figure out how to do it, right? So I think there's a lot of research that should be done on dual enrollment, dual credit, but I think we'll find that in most of our state, the rural community colleges are doing a lot of dual enrollment, dual credit.
So yeah, I'm still going through the chat. There aren't any new questions, but there is some people have put some input and like thoughts and insights. So I'll share some of those if you're interested, Laura. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sure.
So let me just scroll down and find one. Just a quick thought on the employer served metric. It cites employees served. In Virginia, we are doing more and more pre-hire training of individuals that are more often than not do get employed, but are not at the time of training. So it might be splitting hairs, but it's a growing field of training here.
Oh, yeah. That's a great example of something, you know, I think, and I'm interested to hear what Jason would say about this too, but I think one of the things we learned through our conversations was that when communities are trying to figure out how to train employees, right, like how to train employees for a new company coming to town or how to attract a new company, the community college is where they turned, right? Because the community college, especially on the non-credit side, they can react very quickly. They can stand up a program pretty quickly and maybe much more quickly than a four-year college could do it. So that doesn't surprise me, right? That this is going to be kind of a constantly moving, changing thing. And so that's interesting. That's a great, we're taking note of all these things and we'll make sure to take note of that. But yeah, I think we want to be able to incorporate all different ways that community college, and it's not going to be universal, right? It's not going to be perfect, but do a better job of broadening out and collecting all the different ways that they're providing trained employees for the communities that they're serving.
Okay, so this is a question from earlier that I missed, but can you please describe how you expect this data to benefit students in colleges and how this is different than other surveys?
Yeah, I've thought a lot about this actually as I've gone through this, and I think about the different types of students I educated at a four-year school, and the types of students that attend two-year schools are much broader even than what we typically see at four-year schools. But I think about the different students I've taught or advised over the years that wouldn't have been counted in IPEDS, you know, or wouldn't have been counted as a success. I taught students that literally took one class a semester until they graduated with a bachelor's degree. It took them forever to do that. But they were doing it that slow for a reason, right? It was most of the time that they had family, they had jobs, they had full-time jobs, plus they had responsibilities with their family that made it where that was really all they could do. Or there was a financial reason why that was all they could do. It bothers me that we're not counting those people as a success, you know, and if I was that student, it would bother me if I knew that I was kind of tossed out as not succeeding. So do students know they're not counted? No, but I just kind of feel like it's the right thing to do to count those students. I think it will help students evaluate the schools they might want to attend better. I think right now, and there's been some written, there's some studies out there about school counselors being less likely to inform high school students about community colleges and less likely to encourage students to attend community colleges and the stigma attached to community colleges. I think some of that stigma is because of the low graduation rate data that's out there. I mean, if you look that up, it does not look good. And if you were to do a general search of graduation rates for Virginia colleges and you looked at, or any state, you looked at the four-year schools and the two-year schools really do not look very good. Now, that is what the rate is using the same cohort definition across four-year and two-year schools. But I just don't personally, after doing this work, and I think those of us on this team don't believe that cohort is the best way to define it. So we're just doing it a different way. Doesn't mean our way is necessarily better. We just believe it's a more holistic way to view that. So I think it will help students when they're trying to evaluate. It'll be another data point that schools can point to when they're talking about the services they're offering students.
Yeah. And just to
go ahead.
I was going to say, just to add on a little bit about how is this different than other surveys? That's a really important question that we're just not trying to recreate the wheel. what this is, this survey, this data collection method is specific for community colleges, where other post-secondary are specific for either broadly like higher ed or really more geared to 4 years. So what, by creating this program, this survey, we're allowed to define the cohorts in a broader definition. We're able to define what it means to get a credential or a certificate in a way that's more in line with how community colleges think about it, and with different states and different communities think about how to fund community colleges. Should it be universally free? Should they be fully defunded, as some states are looking to do? It really, having this type of information is just another resource that's specific for community colleges and how they're serving the communities outside of just only credit. Because we're also trying to collect the high school, which we're seeing high school students are taking advantage, especially in rural areas, and also non-credit side, and also workforce development. So just having something specific for community colleges is, makes it in itself unique and novel compared to other data collection methods.
Exactly. And just for people who don't know, I'm a research analyst, and I've been like working behind the scenes on the data analysis with Laura and Jason. And someone brought up this, and I'm highlighting all this because I've also thought the same thing. It's, and their comment is, it would also be nice to see impact on wraparound services. For example, did providing a food pantry move the needle in retention and graduation? Same with childcare and other services.
So yeah, I think that's a great point. Like, you know, there are some wraparound services that are funded for four-year institutions that aren't funded for two-year institutions. So help services is one of them in many cases, where a four-year institution, help services is part of what they have, right? So for however many students they have enrolled, they get money for a nurse or a doctor, et cetera. But some of these wraparound services, because they're not funded in the same way for two-year schools, they cost community colleges a lot of money to put in place, right? A child care center is very expensive, right? I mean, that it's not that these places don't want to have child care centers, it's that it's very expensive to do so. But if there could be proof that that actually does move the needle, it might be a different conversation, right? If you felt like it really increased enrollment, then it might be worth doing. But it's difficult to know how to make some of those decisions without available data on those services. So I'm actually really excited about the wraparound service data. It's a simple question, right? Do you have these things or not? It's the simplest part of our survey. But I do think it could, you know, we have some hypotheses about wraparound services. So for example, I might believe that if there's transportation to and from a school, that might really help. There's actually been some things written very recently about that in the state of North Carolina specifically. But we don't know. We don't know because we really don't have good data on that. So this will allow us to do more analysis on that.
Well, fantastic. Another comment that I saw that I thought was really interesting. One possible reason for a Black student undercount in IPEDS may be because many students that identify as Black are counted as multiracial in IPEDS because they indicate that they are other races as well. Also, they could identify Hispanic in IPEDS if they identify as Black and Hispanic.
Correct. We did talk, several of the people that we talked to did mention this, and also mentioned now difficulties in collecting gender data as well. And so these were conversations that we've had that I think Jason would agree we want to talk about a bit more about how to handle that as we go forward, because, you know, census has trouble collecting race data too, right? Like everybody has trouble collecting these sorts of data. Jason, anything you want to add there
we're always trying to evolve how we're collecting information, especially in race, ethnicity, gender, and different like just demographics. It's not easy. But we're always looking to do better, and we appreciate kind of any thoughts or feedback and any partnership in trying to make this as good and as reliable as possible.
And on the note of partnership, our last comment is, please make sure if the data is collected and reported at the system level that you involve the state/system data people in the conversation. It will help improve consistency of the data.
Absolutely. We are very interested in engaging the system level offices and hope that we've already done that in a couple of cases, but want to do that more universally. We think that, you know, the systems are doing an amazing job collecting their own data, and that's very tough work, and they're doing a great job. We're not trying to like step on any toes in that regard for sure. You know, like I mentioned before, we do feel like as kind of like an independent, outside, nonpartisan, you know, we're not funding community college. We're not asking for money for community colleges, right? We don't have any anything directly involved, any direct involvement in the field. We think it can still be valuable for us to put some data out there too. And so some of the data might look and feel and sound very similar to what they're collecting. Some of it might be a little different, but I completely agree. We want to engage with all those system offices.
Okay. I think that's everything we have.
Okay. Well, I thanks, Jacob, for handling the Q&A for us. And, you know, if you have questions and you want to email us, they're going to put up a slide in just a second that will have our email addresses on it again, as well as the QR code to participate. Please do communicate with us. And also, you know, send whatever comments and questions you have, mine and Jason or Jacob's way. We appreciate you attending today. We have recorded today's event, and we will be posting it as soon as we have it edited. We'll post it on our YouTube channel, and we will be sending it out to you guys. So you'll get an email from us, but it'll take just a little while till we get the video edited. And we'll send it out to you so that you can share it with your teams and others that couldn't attend today. So thank you so much for your time, and we look forward to hearing from all of you.
Thank you, everyone.